So how do we manage our finances better so that we can actually free up some of those resources to give more? And then, of course, to save more and to have control over over our money. So the first thing that we need to do, basically the start of everything, no matter what state you are, is to get the big picture, okay? So what's the big picture? And this is whether you're drowning in debt or you're a millionaire, okay? You need to start with these points, because the first keys to responsible management of your finances are: don't spend more than you make, and actually spend less than you make. And I think that even though we talk about this, and this is a very obvious statement, it's not how we often practice. Like many people in the world are not, and especially in our country, are not practicing this, right? So how do we get here? And there are two ways that to start doing that to give us the big picture. And the first is to make our own personal balance statement. And we'll do that in a second. And if you open your folders, there are some very simple templates for our personal balance statement that you can kind of come along with, and for a few other things. And then making sure that you're tracking your spending. So let's kind of go through these quickly. So first, why would we want to do this? Why do we want to get the big picture? For a lot of people, they don't even want to look. They don't want to know, right? Because there's so much fear and so much anxiety associated with money and how we're spending our money. But the fact is that if you start taking a look at what your financial picture is, then you get a little bit of control over that fear. And the second part, and something we'll talk a lot more about tonight, is the idea that looking at our spending, tracking our spending, creating a budget sheet, helps us to align our spending with our values. What have we just talked about as people of faith being influenced by biblical foundations of how we should sharing with people who have less? We can align our spending with the values that we have. And we'll talk a little bit more about how we can identify these values that are unique to us. So first, let's look a little bit at creating a balance sheet. So a balance sheet kind of sounds like it should be a business term, doesn't sound super personal, but it's actually all about what you own versus what you owe. And that's all it is. And then it has all these sort of complicated terms like assets and liabilities, but it comes down to owning and owing. So if you're going to make your own balance sheet, you're going to start with your assets, what you own. Okay? And first you're going to look at your liquid assets, and that just means cash that you can access, right? So cash in your bank accounts, cash that you have under your mattress, cash that you have in other accounts like your 401k or savings and checking, all those types of things. Retirement, stocks, all these elements. And then there's also your hard assets. Maybe you own a house. Maybe you own a car, or maybe you don't own either of these things. Maybe you also own some smaller things like electronics that if you had to, you could sell and gain a certain amount of money. Or you own some furniture or a few things that you might be able to sell. And if you don't have to add those things, but you could tabulate them. And in the end, you're going to add all of them up, and they're going to give you what you own, your assets. And then you have to take a really hard look at your debt. So starting first with credit card debt, because there's a lot, credit card debt is the big scary one. It usually has the highest interest rates. You're going to be spending interest out the nose. And if you don't get a handle on your credit card debt, it can eat you alive, which I'm sure some people have an understanding of that. I've seen how that works in the past. A lot of times we have student loans that we're dealing with, trying to get through school. You might have a car loan, you might have a mortgage, you might have other loans from family or private loans. So you need to find out what those numbers all are and tabulate them and put them into some sort of form, either a spreadsheet, or you can list them out in a paper form and add them up. And then the point of this is to get to your personal net worth. And that, again, also sounds like a term you use for just, you know, the high rollers, right? If you're super wealthy. But your net worth is just your assets minus your liabilities. What you owe own minus what you owe, okay? So when you take that subtraction, you get your personal net worth. And it might be negative. And that's actually, at this point, it might be okay. Because the point is to know, right? And then once you know whether your personal net worth is negative, you can start working on it and start managing some of your finances in a different way. Questions so far? You guys looking, have you guys made balance sheets or anything like that before? Yeah? No? Some? Okay. So yes and no. So the second really foundational principle is to track your spending. And this is the center of everything, okay? And while you're doing this process, I would suggest taking a break from credit cards because the interest rates are so high and everything doesn't happen in real time. You aren't always aware of what you're spending. So while you're tracking your spending over the course of maybe a month or 2 months or 3 months or whatever, you could take a break and just use your debit card or use cash and see what happens to avoid some of that high interest rates. So now let's think about how you track your spending. You can go super low tech, and I used to do this. I used to take around a book. I used to write down every little thing that I spent, from my coffee to my drugstore purchases to anything. And you can do it like that, and then you can check in with your bank or your bills and add in some of the other things and keep a running tally in a very low-tech way. The other thing you can do is save all of your receipts for the whole month and put them in a drawer, put them in a basket. I used to do this, sit down on the floor and tally up all my expenses, put them in an Excel sheet. And thinking about the date, thinking about the location that you're spending and the amount that you're spending. But the thing is that was, when I was doing this, it was before apps and all these wonderful pieces of software that you can use. So a level above now, most people are using online banking and it essentially does this for you, right? It gives you the date, it gives you the place you were and the amount you spent. So if you track in on your online banking and check it out, you can see your statement with your credit card statements and your debit card statements and see all those things. But it's not going to give you necessarily the category of spending that you're looking for. So another step up is our apps that let you manually input some of your expenses, some of the things that you're spending on. Now, these don't connect to your bank, but something like Dollarbird is a calendar-based app, so you can put in things you have spent, things you plan on spending, present income, future income, and the app will tabulate and calculate what your balance will be at a certain point. So if you like to think in terms of time and calendars, it's a helpful app. Wally is also a manual entrance app, and with Wally, it will scan your receipts, which is a really nice feature, and it also has a location tracker. So you're at a particular place, and it'll just say, and then you can add in whatever you spent at a certain place. It'll tally it for you. But of course, one level up from that are programs that'll actually help you track your own spending by connecting with your bank accounts. Do people use Mint here? Yes. Okay, Mint rocks. But there's actually Mint's great, but there's actually a lot of other things that you can use. So if you look at the end, if you look in your resources at the end, I've listed a number of different apps that will do this tracking for you. So if you didn't like Mint or you wanted to explore different user interfaces, there are a bunch of different ones. So like LearnVest does it, Personal Capital does it, Prosper Daily does it. There's a ton of them. Because sometimes Mint can be strange. It doesn't always work seamlessly with everything you want, so it's worth looking at some of the other ones. But you can add all of your accounts in Mint. You can add your loans. You can add all of your retirement accounts. And so you see, it's really cool to see everything in one place and be able to access it. It can help you develop your balance sheet as well. And with Mint, it'll automatically sort of download the things that you spend, your expenses. But it'll also give a guess on the categories of your expenses. But if you don't like that guess, which happens often, you can go in and you can change the category. And it's great on your on a phone app because it happens really quickly. And you can create your own categories to put the expense categories expenses under. So that's totally worth doing. And at the end, you can see all kinds of interesting things. So that's the next part of this. What does this data actually tell you? Right? So you put in your data, and you take a look and you examine every expense that's going out for a month, for 2 months, and what do you see? And the first thing you see are patterns, right? You can sort of create categories and say, this is what I'm spending on this. This is the first steps towards developing a budget. But what you also see is what David Bach, the author David Bach, calls the latte factor. And his book is listed in the resources. And the latte factor are these habits that form for you. So here's more on categories. And Mint will actually show you visuals of the different categories and help you look at them over time, which is great. So David Bach calls this the latte factor. And what the latte factor is like these habits that we get in that we stop noticing. So these habits of buying a coffee, or these habits of paying for parking, or I don't know, taking the car when we can ride our bikes, that kind of thing. And we do that so habitually, and it's just a little bit of money, and we don't realize what the impact is. So for example, if a cup of coffee out is $2, less than $2.70, and you do this every weekday, you're gonna end up with $520 at the end of the year. And that, you know, that's $500 that you could be giving. You can do all kinds of things with $500. So the latte fact, you notice that those patterns in the tracking of your spending. But the other thing that the tracking does is it reveals something about your values. Now, it doesn't necessarily reveal what your values are, but it reveals what you're saying with your spending. And the question is, do you want what you're saying with your spending to be what is shown in your data? Okay. So we're going to talk a little bit now about how we can identify values so that we can spend out of and save and give out of our values instead of reacting to our desires and immediate needs. Okay. Yes.
Do you have any suggestions for, like, when I look at the balance sheet, it just brings up, like, anxiety over, like, and guilt over it, that, oh, we should not have spent that? Mm-hmm. Any suggestions on how to do this process with, like, out jumping right to that and giving up?
Without jumping to guilt and giving up? Yeah, that's actually a really good question. I think, so you're saying doing the tracking of expenses makes you nervous. I think the thing is that if you don't look at it, then you'll never be able to change. So it's a question of how do you actually take some control and then move forward? Mm-hmm. And then once you do that, then you sort of end up lowering the anxiety. But the problem is it takes a little while because you actually have to implement the changes around. And so are you asking like how to push through the anxiety to actually do the work? Pray. Pray, but actually, I think the process of tracking, and not only the process of tracking, but also saying, how can I change? And then doing that change the next day, like okay, I've seen how I did this. I have guilt. It's all in the past. It's a sunk cost, right? You can't get it back. So now I'm going to make 3 changes, right? And then do that for a week and see what happens, and then it can be kind of a snowball. I don't know if that answers your question. It's a tough thing to push through the anxiety. I think not doing it creates more anxiety in the long term. So we need to ask about the why of our spending. Why are we doing what we're doing? But also, why do we think the way we think about money? Why is money important to us, okay? And the point is to say, values that we're gonna determine, we're gonna talk about values and the values around our money here, values aren't goals. They're not like saving for a vacation, creating an emergency fund. Values are a step above goals. They're what driving how we make our goals. So We talked about our responsibility as Christians for caring for those who have less than we do, and that's something that helps to drive our values. But, and our values are also informed by our own personal histories and our stages in life, right? We all have different things that we need to think about in terms of money. So we need to ask the questions, why is money important to me? Why do I need it? What does it give me? And what in my personal history shapes how I feel, like shapes those anxieties and shapes what I turn to for comfort in terms of money? And you'll have a chance to kind of think about that in a little bit in groups. So when I think about, these are some values that I've come up with for myself in terms of money. And the first one, I think money is important to me because I can use it in some way to create margin, create space. I have lived in the past sometimes that have been very, very hectic, and to the point where I've neglected friends, I've neglected family, I've neglected my own mental health, lots of different things. So I don't want to live like that anymore, and money in some way can help me create that space where I don't need to live that way. Whether it's by spending less so that I can work a lot less, or on occasion ordering takeout in a busy week so that I can have space. And the second thing is, for me, care for others. And that can mean, of course, generosity, giving to people sort of out and about, but it also means traveling to visit my family. And it means taking a friend out to lunch or bringing a meal, right? So it's broad for me, and it helps me say, does this purchase that I'm gonna make correspond with either of these values? And there's probably other values that I have too. But it kind of helps me determine how I'm going to spend. But of course, I don't have kids. And I think values for people at different places in their lives, like if somebody has children, maybe they are valuing providing some sort of security for their children or creating more time for family. So values are really different depending on where we are in our personal lives. So this is why I can't just give you a percentage to save and a percentage to give. You need to develop your own idea of what your values are so that you can inform the ways that you want to spend and save and give. So once you've identified values, or as you identify values, something that's closely aligned is coming to a sense of what's enough. Okay, and this is, I just love this idea. What's enough for each person. So this came from Joe Dominguez. He has created this financial integrity program guide. He worked on this material a long time ago in the 80s, and it came out in a book called Your Money or Your Life. But it's also free on the internet, a lot of these ideas and his curriculum at financialintegrity.org. It's in your resources. But what he says is there's this curve and for that kind of shapes your fulfillment and your money spent, right? So how much fulfillment do you get as you spend more money? And so you're spending up till survival mode, and that's good, you need to do that. Your fulfillment keeps increasing as you hit survival, like basic shelter and food. And then you're spending a little bit more for comfort, things like running water, electricity, different things that give us a certain level of comfort, and your fulfillment is going up. And then you're adding what are luxuries, even though we might not always consider them luxuries, anything like TV or dessert or anything we're thinking that we don't actually need. And you're adding these things, but then at some point, and you're getting fulfillment from them, right? But at some point, your fulfillment kind of hits a edge, right? And after you hit that point, the fulfillment that you get from adding more and more and more and more drops off. And this is what he postulates anyway, and I think it makes a lot of sense, right? That extra marshmallow or that extra movie that you go to or whatever, it doesn't give you the same satisfaction that you would get from, you know, one thing. It's very economics oriented. So that point at the top of the curve, right where your fulfillment sort of breaks off, that's enough. So you can figure out What's enough for you? What are the things that make you fulfilled? And that can include how much you're giving away. It should include how much you're giving away. And then where does it start to drop off? And what Joe Dominguez says is actually, you can kind of sense it. You need to give it a little thought, but you can kind of sense where that is, where you really don't feel good cutting anymore. But you have to actually be mindful and take it back to the point of what's enough. So once you identify your values and you decide what's enough, you want to ask these questions after you've tracked your expenditures. Does the expense correspond with my values, the values that I've looked at? Was the expense worth what I spent? And that means, like, did it give you the fulfillment that you actually got for the amount of money that you spent? Like, did that coffee give me the fulfillment that was required from the $2 that I spent on it? Or was it just because I was out and I felt like I wanted something to do, right? And is there something similar that I could buy that would cost less? There's actually an article on your table. It's not the same three questions, but it talks about some people who went through that. It's from the New York Times, and it's fairly recent. It's a really good article, and they asked some similar questions about all of their expenses. And so if you do this for what you already spent, looking in the past and realizing that the past is done, right? Like you said, the past is over, but then you use that feeling and those understandings about what your spending was saying about what you were communicating about your values. And then you say, well, I can use these questions for everything I purchase in the future, right? Like, I don't have to purchase mindlessly. I can ask about every single thing that I buy if it corresponds with my values, if it brought me fulfillment, and if there was something that would cost less. And it makes a difference. So, and the other key reason why understanding your values and understanding what is enough is important is that you're always going to face these huge trade-offs. It's really hard to buy ethically and buy completely frugally all the time, right? Because labor practices are going to raise the prices. And so if my values are determining how I spend, then I can choose one chocolate bar instead of an entire bag of chocolate bars, which is generally probably the comparison. Or, you know, buying local food versus buying non-local food, or all of the possible things, the clothing, fair trade clothing, organic cotton, all the things that are possibly hurting other people that cost a lot more. So there's that trade-off, and there's also the trade-off between giving, saving, and spending. Because at different points in our lives, we might have to save for kids' college, or we might have to save for things that we can't, or we might have to deal with some really, really heavy loan debt, right? And that stuff takes a lot of precedence. And we'll talk about what to do about giving in those situations, giving as a spiritual discipline, but we need to understand our values so that we can make these trade-offs.